Could sadness give you what you want? Before going to where this episode is going, which is the emotional manipulation side of sadness, let's give sadness a chance to redeem itself. Let's delve into the idea that sadness could potentially give you what you want, examining it from different angles and perspectives. Sadness is a natural and essential human emotion. It often accompanies loss, disappointment, or unmet desires. Though painful, sadness can lead to personal growth, self-awareness, and empathy. By reflecting on what causes our sadness, we can gain insight into our true desires and values, which may guide us towards what we genuinely want in life. Sharing feelings of sadness can foster deeper connections with others. When we open up and express vulnerability, it can build trust and empathy in relationships, leading to more authentic and fulfilling connections. Sometimes, sadness acts as a signal that something in our life needs to change. It can serve as a motivator, pushing us to evaluate our current path and make necessary adjustments to align with our true desires. Facing and embracing sadness can be a part of the healing process. Whether it's grieving a loss or working through a personal challenge, allowing ourselves to feel sad can lead to acceptance and ultimately, healing. Many artists, writers, and musicians have used their sadness as a source of inspiration. Channeling emotions into creative expression can lead to beautiful and resonant works of art that connect with others. Some spiritual traditions view sadness as a gateway to deeper wisdom and compassion. By embracing rather than resisting this emotion, individuals may find a path to inner peace and enlightenment. While sadness can be a profound teacher, it's also essential to recognize when professional help is needed. Persistent or overwhelming sadness may indicate a more serious underlying issue, such as depression, that requires professional care. If we consider the question metaphorically, sadness might be likened to a difficult journey through a dense forest. Though the path is challenging and filled with obstacles, it leads to a clearing where clarity, understanding, and true desires are found. The idea that sadness could give us what we want is somewhat paradoxical. While happiness and fulfillment are often sought, it may be the very experience of sadness and the introspection it promotes that guides us toward these goals. In conclusion, the concept that sadness could give you what you want is a multifaceted idea, filled with nuance and depth. While it might seem counterintuitive, embracing sadness can be a path to understanding ourselves better, connecting with others on a deeper level, and ultimately moving towards what we truly desire. It's a concept that invites contemplation and holds potential for personal transformation. Knowing these bases, let's go back to our first question. Could sadness give you what you want? The portrayal of sadness to influence others to meet one's desires is a well-known behavioral pattern. It's often seen in children who learn that displaying sadness can lead to rewards or desired outcomes. This tactic can carry into adulthood as well, where people use emotional expressions to gain sympathy or advantage. In some cultures and social contexts, showing sadness might be seen as a sign of vulnerability or a cry for help. Others might feel compelled to respond to these displays with assistance or concessions. The use of sadness as a strategy may stem from a learned association between showing distress and receiving care or attention. It could be a survival mechanism that has been reinforced over time. While it's natural to want to respond compassionately to someone's sadness, there's a fine line between genuine need and manipulation. Understanding this dynamic requires emotional intelligence and awareness of both self and others. The idea can be illustrated through the story of a child who learns that a pout or tearful expression leads to treats or attention. The child's world becomes a stage where sadness is a tool, a key to unlocking desires. However, as the child grows, they must learn that authentic communication and mutual respect are more effective and honorable ways to express needs and wants. While this tactic might work in some situations, it can also lead to misunderstandings or resentment. If others perceive the sadness as insincere or manipulative, it may damage relationships or trust. Recognizing this pattern within oneself may lead to growth and a more genuine way of interacting with others. It offers an opportunity to reflect on why we might resort to such tactics and how we can communicate our needs and desires more authentically. This theme is not uncommon in literature, film, and other media, where characters might use sadness or other emotions to manipulate others. It reflects a complex aspect of human interaction and psychology. In essence, the idea that sadness could give you what you want, when viewed as a deliberate tactic to influence others, opens up a rich exploration of human behavior, psychology, ethics, and relationships. It poses questions about authenticity, empathy, manipulation, and the intricate dance of human interaction. It's a concept that may resonate with many and provide food for thought about how we express ourselves and strive for what we want in life. Here's a short story about Liam, who learned at early age that pouting helped him obtain what he wanted, later learning that taking action was more fulfilling. Once in a quaint village, lived a young boy named Liam. From a tender age, Liam discovered that a pout or tearful expression could unlock the world's treasures. His world became a stage, and sadness was his tool, a key to unlocking desires. A candy from the store, a toy from a shelf, or even an extra bedtime story, all were his with just a well-timed tear. As Liam grew, so did his understanding of the world. He began to notice that his friends and family were not mere actors in his play but real people with feelings and needs. His sister, Emily, was particularly perceptive and often talked to him about the importance of authentic communication and mutual respect. One day, Liam found himself desiring a beautiful kite that danced in the wind outside the village's toy shop. His first instinct was to put on his practiced pout, but Emily's words echoed in his mind. He decided to try a different approach. Liam approached his parents and explained his desire for the kite, promising to complete extra chores and even save some of his allowance. His parents, recognizing the maturity in his request, agreed to help him achieve his goal. Weeks passed, and Liam worked diligently, honoring his promises. The day finally came when he had enough to purchase the kite. As he held it in his hands, he realized that the joy he felt was unlike any other. It was a joy born from effort, understanding, and genuine communication. The kite became more than a toy, it became a symbol of Liam's growth and a testament to the power of authenticity. He learned that while tears and pouts might open doors, true fulfillment came from connecting with others in a meaningful and respectful way. Liam's story is a gentle reminder that the tools we use to navigate the world must evolve as we grow. The keys that once unlocked desires may become obsolete, replaced by the more profound keys of empathy, understanding, and respect. Liam's early behavior of using a pout or tearful expression to gain treats or attention is akin to a psychological pattern observed in most of us. Just as Liam believed that his sadness was a tool to unlock his desires, many of us may unconsciously believe that our sadness will somehow influence some celestial or cosmic response that will magically fulfill our wishes. Maybe in our early age we learned that our tears were a learned response to our environment, a way to manipulate those around us to achieve what we wanted. Similarly, the psychological pattern of relying on sadness may stem from a belief system that equates suffering with virtue or that views sadness as a means to attract sympathy, support, or even cosmic intervention. As we grew and learned the value of authentic communication and mutual respect, we realized that true fulfillment came from effort, understanding, and genuine connection with others. This realization can be paralleled with the personal growth that comes from recognizing that relying on sadness as a tool is neither healthy nor effective. True fulfillment and achievement in life often require effort, empathy, and a clear understanding of one's goals and the steps needed to reach them. But what if we still unconsciously use this strategy, and we became persistent in feeling sad, expecting to improve our situation? What if we do it over and over, for decades, being not aware of where this pattern is leading us? Instead of going from what's out there to find ourselves, we focus our attention on our inner environment to figure if this is what we're doing. Like explorers navigating the vast oceans of the soul, we set sail inward, where the compass of intuition guides us. The external world, with its noise and chaos, often distracts us from the true essence of our being. But by turning inward, we embark on a journey through the landscapes of our minds, discovering hidden treasures of wisdom and insight. This exploration is not a fleeting adventure but a lifelong quest, where the relationship between our inner psychology and surroundings becomes a dance, a harmonious melody that resonates with the core of our existence. It's a path that requires courage, for it leads to the uncharted territories of our emotions and thoughts, but it's a path that promises a connection with the authentic self, a bond that transcends the superficialities of the world. In this inner environment, we find not only ourselves but the keys to transforming our outer world, making it a reflection of the peace, love, and understanding we cultivate within. Thank you for listening, and see you next.